Hello, everyone, and welcome in. As you enter, please say hello in the chat. Hi, great to have you all here. My name is Lee Constable, and we'll be starting in a moment once everyone's in. Please say hello in the chat. I'd like to start by acknowledging that I'm broadcasting to you as part of this innovation series from Gadigal land. So please, as you come in, say hello, let me know whose land you're on, and also feel free to include some details about yourself, if you're coming from industry, business, policy, from research and science. It's a great way to know who's out there in the crowd. My name is Lee Constable, and I'll be hosting this, the latest installment in the innovation series. This one is on advanced manufacturing supporting green technologies. And of course, this is a collaboration between ANSTO and Science Meets Business. It's a big topic. So let me just start to get you into the mindset of thinking about the things that we're going to be speaking about today. So embracing green technologies is already starting to transform Australia's manufacturing sector in different ways. And we've got a lot of global and local opportunities and challenges ahead. Building Australia's manufacturing capability and renewable energy sector was highlighted in the recent budget. It has also been the subject of a lot of public comment from the Minister for Industry and Science, Ed Husic, as well. And renewables and low emissions technologies is one of the priorities of the National Reconstruction Fund. So a thriving advanced manufacturing sector will see Australia hit its sustainability targets and lead the world. That's the hope, the dream for the future. And right now, COP27 is taking place in Egypt, further bringing to the front of our minds what part Australia can play when it comes to shaping the future we want to see. I'm going to be speaking with four panelists today, and they're going to be taking my questions, but yours as well, which is why chat is so important. So hello, Viet, hello, Paul, hello, Adrian, Claire, great to see you all in the chat. And Heather is also in the chat as well. You'll see her sharing some links potentially later as we go. So keep an eye on that for resources as well as chat. So let me introduce our four panelists. I'll introduce them one by one and then give you a chance to get to know them before we open up the whole panel to audience questions. First of all, I want to introduce Dr. Jitendra Mata, who is an instrument scientist at ANSTO. Dr. Jitendra is a JIT, if you want to use his nickname that he loves going by, is a senior instrument scientist for the Kookaburra, which, having been to ANSTO now, I know is actually an instrument. All of them, for those who aren't from ANSTO, are named after Australian animals. Kookaburra is an ultra small angle neutron scattering instrument. And also JIT works on quokka, which is a small angle neutron scattering instrument. So he's going to tell us more about that and his work at the Australian Centre for Neutron Scattering, which is ACNS, also ANSTO and the Synchrotron. Welcome, Dr. Mata, Jitendra. What types of advanced materials are you working on, and how does that fit into this overall theme of green technology?
Thanks, Lee, for your kind introduction. And hello, everyone. I am joining you today from Dharawal country. I acknowledge the traditional owner of the land and pay my respects to elder past, present, and emerging. Now, coming back to your question, Lee, ANSTO is a custodian of large-scale infrastructure, as you mentioned. I work at Australian Centre for Neutron Scattering, which is on the Lucas Hyde campus at ANSTO. We have 15 different type of highly specialized neutron scattering instrument. I mainly use three of these 15 instrument to study the material at nano and micron length scale. Now, just to give you the size perspective, human hair is roughly 75 micrometer. And the length scale I study in my research are at least 25,000 times smaller than the thickness of human hair. So what is the benefit of studying structure at such a small length scale? Let me give you one example. So in my In my research, one of my collaborative projects with University of New South Wales, we developed very thin, ultra-light fire retardant material. We use the material called Maxine. It's a titanium carbide material. We mix this material with chitosan, which is found in the prawn shell. So you can see how two materials are combined. By using neutron scattering, we were able to see this material at nanoscale level and see how they organize themselves. If we understand this, then we can make better material, more greener material. The material which we develop can be applied as a paint, can be applied as a coating, or you can spray on any other materials. What we found in our research that by doing this, it only increased the weight of the other material by 5%. However, it gives the improve the fire retardancy by 60 to 70%. So this is amazing. I'll also give you another example, which is with my long-term collaboration with RMIT researcher from RMIT University, where we are using silk to produce this hydrogel for biomedical application. As you know, silk is one of the strongest natural material known to human. However, it has its own limitation. In our research, we mix silk with various other natural or artificial material to produce different type of tailor-made gel. So you can make gel for certain application. By studying this material at nano and micron length scale, using this amazing instrument we have, you mentioned about Kookaburra and Quokka, we can study this material at that length scale, and by doing that, we can better design material for certain application. For example, the same silk can be used for the tissue repair application differently than for the drug delivery material differently. So by understanding material at that length scale will provide us this ability. We can now even 3D print this material. So just to sum up, these two examples can give you how by the use of neutron scattering and material science, we can transform this particular industries. Not only it helps to develop greener and more sustainable material, but also helps to improve the life of many people and, of course, environment as well.
Thanks so much. I think that gives us a great introduction to what you do. And please have in mind some questions for Jit today, if you've got any, particularly about the nanoscale even level of developing new materials for a greener world. Thank you so much. And we will come back to you soon with more questions. Our next speaker that I'll introduce to you is Dr. Nadia Court, who is inaugural director of the Semiconductor Sector Service Bureau, otherwise known as S3B. Nadia was the technical director of the Research and Prototype Foundry and the University of Sydney's Micro and Nano Fabrication Facility. That's what that was. And the Sydney hub of the New South Wales node of the Australian National Fabrication Facility, who some of you in the audience may know as ANFF. So Nadia, welcome. And for those who aren't familiar, could you please explain what S3B is?
Thanks, Lee. I'm also coming to you today from Gadigal land. I thought it would be useful for people in the audience to maybe give a bit of an introduction to S3B. And I guess how the history behind this is the Office of the Chief Scientist and Engineer in New South Wales actually commissioned a report, I think it was in late 2020, into the semiconductor sector in Australia. And some questions kind of might come up as, do we even have a semiconductor industry? And the answer is we do. It's quite small. And this report was really looking into, you know, what are the strengths and opportunities, but also the challenges that this industry face. And one of the key recommendations of that report was to establish this Semiconductor Sector Service Bureau. It's recently been announced this year that this Semiconductor Bureau, or S3B, would be established. And it's actually hosted as a joint venture between Macquarie University, the University of Sydney, and UNSW Sydney, in collaboration with the Australian National Fabrication Facility and the CSIRO. And really what we're aiming to focus on is, supporting that very small industry, but also to really look into establishing opportunities to take that industry forward. So we've got a few key areas that we're looking to focus on. And I suppose a way of kind of summing them up is that S3B is going to enable access to things like supply chain capabilities, market intelligence, expertise and talent within the semiconductor sector. We're looking to do that by kind of performing a couple of key functions. And the first is around kind of ecosystem development, making sure that there's good links between people in research and industry, allowing people within the industry to kind of link up and network to capability that they may be looking for. Looking at things like skills and training of people working in this industry. That's definitely a key factor in one of the reasons why a lot of these businesses tend to move overseas is the lack of local talent. I kind of mentioned also the supply chain capability. So that's going to be a big part of what we do, brokering access into supply chain, both overseas, but also here locally, to really allow companies that are trying to establish themselves in this space to get a foothold within the industry and access those supply chains that they need. So that's kind of just the summary of what the S3B is going to look to do.
Awesome. Thank you so much, Nadia. And you'll see Heather has put in the chat a link as well for those of you in the audience who are looking for more information, as well as a link to the work that JIT's team are doing at ANSTO. Well, we'll come back to you with more questions, Nadia. Now I'll introduce our third speaker, who is Dr. Alex Hahn, who is another speaker who can speak about that collaboration between research and industry. Dr. Hahn is a silicon irradiations engineer at ANSTO. We're going to be talking a lot about silicon because before joining ANSTO Silicon, Alex had 10 years of experience in advanced silicon solar cell research and manufacturing at the School of Photovoltaics and Renewable Energy, UNSW. So I know your work focuses on production planning, process optimization, advanced calibration, and your silicon irradiation services, but could you start by explaining to people what this technology is, and specifically NTD? What does that stand for and what does that mean?
Well, thanks for the introduction, Lee. I'm Alex Hahn. I'm an engineer here at ANSTO Silicon. I'm speaking from the Darawa land of Lucas Height. Back to your question, the NTD technology refers to neutron transmutation doping of silicon. During the process, a silicon ingot is loaded to our irradiation facility in the OPO nuclear reactor. The ingot, which is a shiny cylindrical crystal, is essentially immersed in a cloud of neutron particles. By random chance, some neutrons will end up being absorbed by silicon atoms, and through a chain of events, turning a small fraction of silicon atoms into phosphorus atoms. The density and distribution of such phosphorus impurity determines the resistivity of the material, which is a critical parameter for our customers in the semiconductor industry. Compared with other doping methods, the NTD technology at ANSTO can achieve high resistivity targets tailor-made per customer requests. For these high resistivity, we are talking about parts per billion level of accuracy. It is done with excellent precision as well as superior spatial uniformity. So these benefits makes NTD silicon the ideal choice as the base material or substrate for high-end power electronic devices. So there are market research showing ANSTO dominates the global NTD silicon market by over 50%. End products are high power electronic devices, such as thyristors and IGBTs. So these devices are like the gates and switches in a circuit, in a high power circuit. All around the world, there has been a transformation of modernization of power system. This is done through electrification, decarbonization, or simply adaptation of new technologies. So ANSTO silicon has been playing a critical role in this industry, industrial revolution. Our end use application includes ultra high voltage power grid, transmission lines, high speed trains, data center, wind turbine, solar system, you name it. So in recent years, there has also been an increasing uptake in the electrical vehicle industry. So this is for both onboard application as well as to be used for charging stations. Mm-hmm. So yeah, so basically any application involves high voltage and high current.
Great. Thank you so much for that overview. I think sometimes, you know, with these instruments, like I could see actually Opal behind Jit earlier. It's not until you start to talk to people like you engineers that you realize that there's this application between this amazing technology and way of using the technology and the end goal, which is sustainability. So thank you so much. I can see already that there's one question for you in chat that I will come back to. Thank you, Adrian. But I'll introduce our fourth speaker first. So our next speaker is Emma Jenkin, who is Investment Director at Calara Capital. Emma has over 20 years experience in finance across portfolio management, fixed income and impact investing, and she's considered a climate pioneer and has led a number of domestic and global innovations across the clean energy transition, ESG investing, carbon finance and emissions trading. Emma, please could you give us your perspective? I know you come from, we've gone from the nanoscale up to the investor's perspective now on what you're looking for. We've got some excited dogs in the background.
Sorry, the postman always comes by at the wrong time. Sorry.
Must have known. I was wondering if you could give us your perspective as an investor on, you know, what the areas are for potential. And I know you mentioned in our briefing your four pillars for investing.
Sure. Yeah. Thank you. And I'm coming today from the Wurundjeri country. So Calara Capital, we focus on investment in climate solutions. And so these are companies that have already got proven technology. So it's already commercialized. So we're at sort of the other end of the pipe. But the key areas that we focus on are the energy transition, circular economy, environmental markets, and I'm missing one, future food. Thank you. And so for us, I think the bit that's been really interesting and just talking about like the broader trends that we're seeing in terms of manufacturing in Australia that we've seen both in our businesses, but also we're seeing more also across startups and government focus is really around the onshoring of manufacturing. So, you know, there's a few reasons for that that are worth kind of just touching on briefly. And, you know, it started off, I guess, with COVID supply chain concerns and then continued with the Ukraine-Russian war and the disruption there. But I actually think there's a bigger thematic happening as well around the climate transition. And, you know, all countries are going to be hopefully soon racing to get to net zero faster and faster, and securing supply at a local level is going to be critical there as well. So all those lead to onshoring. And then you can add, you know, cost has always been the reason that's put forward that you can't manufacture in Australia. But that's also shifting because with carbon costs, the associated footprint matters, and there's increasing focus on scope 3. Like we just saw yesterday, Apple announced that they're now going to all their suppliers and they want to see their decarbonisation plans. And that's going to happen more and more. So there is a real advantage and benefit, particularly for a country like Australia, of manufacturing here. And that will only speed up as we have more and more renewables come onto the grid, which allows manufacturing production to be cleaner and cleaner. And then the other thing we're seeing is government. Like government is funding a lot of this transition through grants. We see that in the electric vehicle charging space where we've got a portfolio company in that area and the government is providing a lot of funding for that rollout of infrastructure. So they also want that to be Australian-based manufacturing. They want to create jobs in the transition as well. And then the final component, just super briefly, is really around that cost factor as well. We're seeing small batch processing and 3D printing really meaning that, particularly if you've designed something in Australia, that you can then manufacture that here and do that in a cost competitive way. So that's, you know, that's some of the broad brush sort of things that we're seeing. And I would definitely say 10 years ago, no one was talking about manufacturing in Australia, except maybe the government, but now everyone is talking about how we set up manufacturing capabilities and capacity in Australia.
Yeah, great. Thank you so much for that overview. Now, I want to invite everyone again in the audience to feel free to write in the chat, as I know Adrian has done already, with questions for multiple members or even a single member of our panel. I'll start with the question that Adrian's already asked. I think this was a question for Alex. What is the current balance of use of silicon irradiation versus other uses such as nuclear medicine, and is there a priority for one over the other?
We share the nuclear reactor, but we nuclear medicine production and silicon irradiation services are not produced in the same facility. Silicon irradiation ultimately has commercial value, but medical nuclear production has a social responsibility side of it. So we are trying to expand our silicon irradiation capacity. However, it shouldn't by any means like hinder our productivity for nuclear medicine.
Awesome. Thanks, Alex. Now I wanted to touch on something that Emma mentioned and asked Jit if you could comment on 3D printing, given that you're at the nano end looking at materials. How have you seen this technology change the way things are happening?
Yeah, so in terms of producing a material, now it's becoming more and more localization, right? So for example, in hospital sector where you have to print certain tissue on go, you can have production right there and you can choose material based on the requirement or based on what application is for that particular reason. So I think 3D printer, not only in biomedical application, but in all other sectors as well. For example, 3D printed solar cells. So this is something which can reduce the wastage of material significantly moving forward. I think there is a significant potential, and especially country like Australia, which is already doing quite well in 3D printing sector.
Yeah, that's great to hear. There's a question that's just come through for Emma from Gabrielle, who asks, what proportion of manufacturing in Australia is done by small to medium businesses? And following on from this, is it interesting or viable for the government to look for ways to help automate processes and decarbonize them for smaller manufacturers? And how could that be achieved? Emma.
I'll have a go at that question, but I'm not a manufacturing expert, so I can't provide you those numbers in terms of a breakdown. But I can talk to what I'm seeing in Victoria. And the Victorian government is very focused on manufacturing jobs in the state. And so through several of their agencies, what we're seeing is, and this happened with one of businesses in our portfolio called Jet Charge, which is the electric vehicle charging company. They are manufacturing some of their hardware in Australia. And part of that is, again, that cycle of, well, they want quality control. They're still relatively small batches, but also Australian content is really important in those grants in that process. And then through discussions with the Victorian government, they've actually got some grant funding to expand some of that manufacturing process. And that's certainly a small manufacturer that's doing contract manufacturing for a multitude of different producers. So, you know, I can't answer it sort of completely directly, but I think there is a real focus and desire for government to help provide the capital to scale up capacity. And often that's the bit that's missing, is that someone might have some manufacturing capacity, but the capital required to either upgrade the technology or to expand is difficult to get. And that is really going to be a government role. Private capital will find it difficult to fund that sort of investment.
Yeah, that's great to know. And I also wanted to bring Nadia into the discussion at this point to talk about that kind of aspect from your perspective, Nadia, when it comes to getting things from research to industry, you're also at this middle point. Where do you see the opportunities and challenges?
Yeah, I guess I can kind of comment similarly to Emma. The New South Wales government has actually made some quite a lot of investments in the semiconductor space in the last kind of 12 months or so. One of those is in, advanced manufacturing facilities that are going to be going out in Western Sydney near the new airport. And I guess the focus of these is, you know, I'm very familiar with research infrastructure facilities that are kind of available at universities, such as the Australian National Fabrication Facility. The facilities that they're planning on building out in Western Sydney, I guess, are looking at taking a step beyond that. So once you've kind of developed your you know, proof of concept, maybe within a university facility, you then actually need to go and show that you can make a product out of that. And so these facilities are looking at kind of taking it to the next kind of stage or technology readiness level. So how can you actually potentially, you know, scale up production and use industry compatible processes? The other problem is you can't just go straight from a university facility right through into a foundry. The difficulty with the semiconductor supply chain is you're often competing with much larger companies like Apple, like Microsoft, that can get them their foot in the door. And so these facilities that are going to be funded out in Western Sydney should allow people to kind of take that small to medium volume kind of production and be able to show proof of concept. In some cases, there may be no need to go beyond that volume. It may be that production can be done at that scale. If you're looking at kind of more like consumer products, then that's when you actually need to think about going to the next stage, which we don't really have the value chain here in Australia. We've got no industry that can kind of do it those sorts of volumes, but perhaps focusing on that, you know, having that sovereign capability, bringing it in-house and being able to do it small volumes is something that maybe we can do with government support.
Yeah, great. Thank you for that, Nadia. We've got a couple of questions in the chat that have come through for Alex next. So we've got a question from John who asks, why can't you use UV or deeper multiphoton laser excitation to generate defect states or etching in the silicon? And do you really need to use nuclear given costs? And said, maybe I missed the target application.
Sure. I'm not familiar with the UV or deeper multiphoton laser method that John outlined here, but I can relate to other standard industrial doping methods, such as iron implantation, or like more traditionally doping in a high temperature gaseous furnace. So the key benefit for NTD technology is the uniformity of doping that we can produce spatially through the entire ingot. And after slicing up the ingots into wafers, you can get like a big wafer within having any points measured on the plane, on the wafer plane, to be within a few percent difference from each other, resistivity wise. So this probably leads up to the answer to your next question, like why does this apply to high voltage and high power device market applications? So I've seen some of the end applications build one device out of one wafer. So these are pretty huge devices compared to carving up 100 little cells out of one wafer. So you have to make sure each point on the wafer have a relatively similar resistivity to minimize, I guess, internal resistivity within the device to start with.
Great, thanks, Alex. And thanks to Corey as well for your question, which Alex also, I think, addressed in that one. We've talked a lot about supply chain in different ways. I was wondering if Emma had brought up the topic of fermentation. Emma, could you please expand on what part fermentation has to play in this whole manufacturing and green tech space?
Sure. So this relates, in the instances I'm looking at it anyway, relate to future food. So an area that we look at very closely is what alternatives to meat products and dairy. And so within precision fermentation, there's a lot of work happening in Australia, but there's a bit missing in that development and manufacturing stage, and that is around a large scale facility. And it's several years off before requiring that. The science hasn't quite got there. But there's this concept that's being worked on by several people within the industry at trying to get a shared facility that would essentially allow a lot of these companies that are creating this new technology to, you know, it might be replacing milk, it could be cheese, there's a multitude of other applications as well. That they could actually share this facility so that they can get to a scalable amount in order to be able to go to market with the product. Because Australia has two main supermarkets which you send most product through, which is Coles and Woolies, and they can only actually put your product on the shelf if you can provide sufficient volume. So for a lot of these companies, they're stuck between the two. So maybe they could do small batch, but actually they need to get to large scale. And the cost of that facility is too great. For that startup, and it's an inefficient use of capital. So what it would require is we'd have multiple of these facilities to meet each of the different startup or new companies' requirements. In order to speed up the transition, people are working on how do we create shared facilities? And I think this could have application as Nadia has highlighted in helping smaller companies to bring their new tech to manufacture here on the first a batch, small scale, and then larger scale.
Yeah, great. Thanks so much for highlighting that gap. Maybe there's someone in the audience who could help to fill that. The next thing I wanted to talk about, Jit, has given us already two examples of the ways that his work in materials can apply to a more sustainable future. Jit, I was wondering if you could speak a bit about nanoplastic, because you know, packaging and other things are really important in this. Could you explain that example of your work?
Yeah, so as you know, plastic is the biggest pollutant right now, and it's one of the challenge all humankind is facing right now. And what my research was looking is how this plastic actually breaks down in a smaller and smaller piece. So when it is up to the micron length scale, you know, there are research suggests that it has very limited impact on the humans and other animals. However, we have no idea how it impacts when it actually breaks down even at a smaller length scale. So my collaboration with the Auckland University, what we have found, how protein actually interacts with plastic when it breaks down to the nanoscale level. Now, you might ask how it is related to the industrial, you know, what we were trying to understand when the new surface is created, when the plastic is break down, and how protein actually interact with that and what impact that will have on the cells or humans or, you know, other animals in general. But it also gives us opportunity to understand how we can actually develop better plastic or the better processing of the plastic so that we don't end up in this kind of situation where we are dealing with the nano level plastic, because our research clearly identify that when plastic is at that length scale, it has a very severe impact. You know, protein forms a very strong bonding with that plastic, and it can have significant impact on the marine life as well as humans. So that's what we are trying to do. We are trying to use this highly specialized technique and the neutrons from the reactor to understand that length scale, how this plastic and protein interacts, or if we can develop a better processing for the recycling of plastic, then you know, we can understand at that length scale.
Yeah, great. And Heather's just shared a link to ANSTO's page on the impacts of plastics in our oceans. when we're talking about plastics and packaging, Emma, I was wondering if you could tell us from your perspective as an investor how important packaging and plastic is to the whole picture that you're looking at.
Yeah, so I mean, packaging is a really big problem. We just saw in Melbourne today, they've announced that they're no longer going to collect the soft plastics and recycle them, you know, from the supermarkets. So the solution, one solution we had is not working. So we have a very big problem here in terms of finding alternate solutions to petro-based plastics. And so we've looked at this space in a lot of detail, and there's a couple of Australian companies that I'll shout out to here, which their names are Umu and Kelpie, and they're both creating alternatives to petroplastics using seaweed, so seaweed biomaterials. And so for us, there's two reasons we look at plastic. One is the terrible impact on our oceans, on our health, on our rivers. And the other is that it's expected to be the major use of petrochemicals or petro products going forward as we decarbonize and electrify. So removing petroplastics is critical to us reducing our carbon footprint as well. So it's, you know, it's for both reasons.
Yeah, thanks. And Heather's shared Ulu and Kelpie in the chat there. Marzio just made a comment. Interesting. It'd be interesting to have RedCycle as curbside solution rather than in-store.
That's RedCycle that's just said they won't collect any more plastic.
Yeah. So potentially, you know, giving them more plastic won't necessarily solve the problem. Great. Thank you so much, Emma. Nadia, I want to invite you back as well, because we've been talking about fermentation, other types of manufacturing. But what would it take for us to have a semiconductor industry in Australia?
It's a very tricky question, Lee. I guess we do have a small amount of semiconductor manufacturing happening here in Australia. I guess it's kind of in very niche areas. So the semiconductor industry in Australia has some real strengths in RF electronics, communication, wireless, Wi-Fi was invented here. There's also a lot of work going on in materials development, particularly in the compound semiconductor space. However, I guess a lot of what those companies are actually working on is still relatively small volume. And it's not necessarily applications in the consumer electronics space. So if we're looking overseas, for instance, to places like Taiwan, where they have a very big manufacturing industry, in fact, they're the largest manufacturers in the world in the semiconductor space, their key focus and application is really in consumer electronics. And it's very difficult to see Australia having manufacturing capability of the scale that happens in places like that overseas. However, I see that there are potentially opportunities maybe in more niche areas. We've got a lot of great research. It's already kind of mentioned some materials research happening here in Australia. There's a lot of work happening in the quantum space as well. And so there's kind of opportunities for future industries and maybe looking at, you know, the areas of excellence, both in industry and in research, that could potentially kind of drive those future industries. I think the difficulty, though, in also setting up an industry is just thinking about just going back to the kind of supply chain issue. Semiconductor products are incredibly complex to fabricate and manufacture. And there's lots of different pieces in the supply chain. So there's everything from the kind of raw materials that you use through to the materials that you're then kind of manufacturing within the facility. There's also then things like the chemicals and the gases that are used. There's the equipment that you use. And then there's also things like power and like electricity, power, water, et cetera, that are required. You also have then things like design tools that you need to actually design the semiconductors that you're going to make. So it's very, very complex. I don't think actually any one country has all of that. And so this is probably one industry that's very difficult to localize. it's also very difficult to see how Australia can kind of really build up a big industry without having multiple parts of that here. So the Semiconductor Bureau is really just a catalyst to kind of start a lot of what's happening here. We're focusing very, very early on, particularly in the supporting the design space, so fabless semiconductor companies that potentially need access to that global supply chain. And the reason for that is there's not a lot of capital needed to kind of set that up. Hopefully through some of the investments that, governments are making in kind of manufacturing capability, looking at kind of future technologies, that might help to grow the need to then establish an industry in a future state. But I think we're still a little way off, and, you know, hopefully we can create a lot of good things in the next few years that allow that to happen.
Yeah, I've got a question actually for you, Nadia, that's just come through from Marzio, who says, I saw articles about the production battery cells from crab shell, wondering if other input materials can be used.
That's a really great question. And actually, I was reading an article in preparation for this that actually made me think that this is a real opportunity, potentially for Australia, given our knowledge in the material space. So look at developing new materials that can be used within the semiconductor supply chain. The great difficulty in that very complex beast that is the semiconductor industry, though, is that a lot of these manufacturing companies that are in the semiconductor space, they have very well refined processes, like production processes, that if you were to change a chemical or a gas, they have to requalify their whole process, and it's a very costly and expensive thing to have to do. However, I think the drive for sustainability and towards carbon zero is actually making a lot of these companies decide that they actually need to look at that. So Taiwan in particular, being one of the biggest manufacturers, they I was very surprised to hear that one of our largest exports in New South Wales is to Taiwan, and it's actually coal. And so we're actually powering the semiconductor industry in Taiwan with our exports. Now, I think there's an opportunity for Australia to potentially look at, okay, we're moving away from these types of dirtier technologies as far as power is concerned into renewables. Is there ways that we can partner with people? Are there things that we can do and develop to support growth in that space?
Great. Thank you so much, Nadia. That's I love that Marzio was just bringing that up, and you've read a similar article. I was wondering, Jitendra, could I get you back on screen, given that we're talking materials, and also apart from Marzio's point, Gabrielle has said recycling soft plastics to manufacture graphene for new supercapacitors. What are your thoughts when it comes to things like crab shell and I know you mentioned prawn shells as well. As a materials engineer, what do you see as potential for materials for the future?
Yeah, there is a huge potential for using upscaling. So there are so many biomaterial which we can extract and develop a composite material from this generally material which goes to the waste. So chitosan is one of the example biomaterial. There are a lot of other examples. There is a protein called resilin, so it is found in insect tandem, and you can use that material for producing more tougher and more elastic material. In the food sector as well, there are material which were traditionally not used for certain application now are more available to use. So there is a huge, as a material development, composite material development, there is a huge potential. There was one other question about, you know, the useful of neutrons scattering when looking to the property at nanoscale level, if I may answer that one as well.
Yeah, please do.
So I built my career in neutron scattering, so I can talk about, you know, talk 1 hour for just to praise the about the neutron. But what is the benefit? The benefit is it has the super high penetration when it comes to the material characterization compared to the other technique. So we now have an ability to study material in their natural state. For example, batteries, you know, you can do a lot of battery research while you are charging battery or discharging battery using the neutron scattering technique. There is another example. I work with a researcher in Japan who are trying to understand how particles interact with each other and using this knowledge to develop better medicine. And at that length scale, you need a neutron or X-ray to penetrate at that length scale and also to interact with material at that landscape. And that brings to, you know, again, your question, how this material development. So now we have ability to study things at that length scale, and that helps us to use material from the waste or, you know, material, for example, chitosine, to form more composite material and use it for the different application.
Thank you so much, Jit. I'll now invite your colleague, Alex, for one final question before I'll just prime everyone on the panel that I'm going to ask you all, you know, if money was no factor, what you'd spend it on, specifically about the manufacturing and green technology question. You know, I'm sure you've got plenty of other ideas. Alex, I wanted to ask you if you had any perspective you could give on what ways we can better have research and industry interacting, given that that's such a huge part of your role.
Before coming to ANSTO Silicon, I worked in photovoltaic solar cell research at UNSW. UNSW had one of the world's most successful solar program, and technologies developed in the university has pretty much dominated every major milestone of every generation of solar cell design. So I think it will be important for the industry, the public sector, and research and investment to work together to figure out what's our strength and make the suitable standard and policy that enables the realization of and transformation from technology to pipeline production and eventually scaling up to manufacturing.
Great, thank you so much, Alex. I'll come back to you to ask you about your fantasy way to spend money in this space. I'll go in the opposite order that we started in. So I'll ask you first, Emma, what would be if you had someone with a big bucket of endless money and you could tell them how to invest it and where to put it, what would you say?
I would say into commercializing marine materials. So, for example, seaweeds, whether that be deep sea seaweed sequestration, plastic removal. You know, there were lots of good things here on, you know, whether it's crabs or prawn shells. I think that a lot of the solutions exist in nature, but we're unable to get them, or it's difficult to get them from the research through to the commercialization, mm-hmm. And then to replace existing materials.
Yeah, great. Well, hopefully someone with a bucket of money is listening. Alex, I'll come back to you. What would your answer be? Where would you like to see a big fantasy bucket of money go?
I work in the NTD space. So if I had the money, I would explore the space of building more new nuclear reactors, and which support have the design and function supporting semiconductor industry through maybe NTD technology, maybe something else.
So more ANSTO.
Yeah, let's go.
Great answer. Thank you so much, Alex. Nadia, how about you?
I suppose my answer is kind of a bit of an overlap between Emma and Alex's answer, in the sense that I think commercialization, but also infrastructure, is kind of required. So honestly, I think the ability to scale the research that's happening within universities is kind of critical. And the only real way to be able to do that is to actually take it outside of the universities and look at having something that is more akin to an industrial manufacturing facility. So I think that there needs to be investment in that sort of space. I can see, I saw something's just popped up in the chat. The returns aren't so attractive, and I agree that they're not. It's really expensive to run these facilities, not just make them, but also run them. Like, ongoing operational costs are actually very expensive. And I think that one thing that needs to happen is there needs to be a change in recognizing that actually the research infrastructure is actually really critical for any economy to be able to commercialize some of the research that's going on. And they've shown that, you know, countries that are very successful at taking that that research and then going through and commercializing it have really vibrant ecosystems and industries. So I think it's essential for Australia to do that.
Yeah, thank you so much. And Jit, what would your answer be?
I am quite surprised. We have a very diverse panel, and everyone's answer is very similar, you know, investment in technology and investment in research. And I am purely from research background, and I'm so fortunate to work, at neutral scattering facility. And I understand the importance of investment in this sector, which have a significant impact in future or future economy. I'll just give you one example. So there is a research we were conducting on the how to recycle the plastic, in terms of, you know, instead of using heat, we were using a high pressure. So you can't do this research without having such a diverse research facility. Mm-hmm. And definitely, you know, more money means more avenue to the explore. This discovering the technology, discovering the product which are not exist yet and which might change the future for good, you know. So I am all in favor of investing more money in the research and especially making more large-scale research infrastructure.
Great. And Jude, where would people go if they want to know more about what you do or your area or how to get involved with ANSTO? And I'll ask Alex to also comment on this too.
Yeah, good question. So the center I mentioned about the Australian Center for Neutron Scattering. Similarly, we have Australian Synchrotron in Melbourne. Both are part of ANSTO. So ANSTO website is a really good point to start. But also in general, if you Google, you know, neutron scattering and how it is applied in material science, you will see a lot of research, really nice research happening. And also it's a cross-organized national research which is going to lead in future material development. I work with CSIRO as well on the food proteins, basically to develop, to understand how food get digested and, you know, how we can actually improve the milk or other food products. So all this information is available online, and, you know, you can read the publication, but also contact our wonderful scientists here at ANSTO. ANSTO is very proactive in terms of, you know, spreading the awareness of what we are doing here. So please visit ANSTO website, or please visit Australian Centre for Neutron Scattering website.
Great. And Alex, did you have anything else you'd like to add if people want to get in touch for collaboration?
Our collaboration is primarily with industrial partners. We work closely with wafer manufacturers around the world to develop, improve our collaboration with our products, and also develop advanced process and collaboration for the NTD silicon process. Yes, you can find more information on the ANSTO website, and feel free to reach out.
Great. Now, Emma, I want to ask you, who would you like to hear from? And, you know, who are your, I know as an investor, you probably get a lot of people messaging you about things that aren't relevant, but who are you looking to hear from? Who are you inviting to get into your inbox?
That is a great question. So as I said, the investment mandate of our fund is later stage. So it's when a product has been commercialized. So there's early customer sales and the business is looking to scale up. So it is later stage. Mm-hmm. Although I would, you know, there are once an idea or the research has reached a stage, there are paths to commercialization, you know, through like Main Sequence and a few other organizations that are out there that assist with that piece of taking it from the research to the product market fit and to the and also to meeting customers and building the business. So we're definitely at the other end of the the technology readiness spectrum. But yeah, so any, you know, businesses that have, so it's already, it's a business, I guess that's one of the key points, mm-hmm. but businesses that have a product in the market and are looking for scale up capital. And so I guess just quickly, some of the things we bring is we bring our national and international network to help the business in that scale up. So really to accelerate the impact that business can make in addressing climate change.
Yeah, great. And good to hear, you know, Main Sequence as an example of a place you can go if you're at that stage beforehand and looking to get to the stage where you can talk to someone like Emma about what you're up to. Thank you so much, Emma. Now, of course, Nadia, it's how do we get in touch with you? What sort of things would you like to hear from people? You know, how do people find out more about what you do?
Unfortunately, we don't have a website yet because I'm still at very early stages of establishing the organisation. However, people can definitely get in contact with me. I suppose I'm really interested in talking to people who are either in the semiconductor industry or they're looking at using semiconductors within the technology that they're looking to commercialize, for instance, particularly if they have issues in accessing supply chain or they don't know where to go. I think that's, we're really looking to be able to support those people. I'm also very keen to hear from people who feel like they can actually contribute to what it is that we're trying to do. So we're trying to build that ecosystem. And so we actually want to engage members of the community to get involved. There are lots of people out there who have been successful at commercializing technologies. We'd love to hear from them. They have lots of contacts within the network. I might tap Alex on the shoulder and ask him, where his contacts are within the industry as well. So what we're really trying to be is to be the point at which people come to when they don't know where to go next, and hopefully we can guide them through that system. And it may very well be that we guide them back into the research space because maybe it's not quite ready for them to take that next step, or maybe we can help them actually access that global supply chain.
Great. Thank you so much. And thank you to our entire panel. It's been great to hear from you all and really get a picture of where we are and where we want to be next in terms of advanced manufacturing and supporting green technology. There's a link there to Nadia's LinkedIn as well, given that she's said that she'd love to hear from you if you're someone who wants to contribute and you've got experience in that realm. This has been one of a whole series, and we do have more in the innovation series of webinars coming up. So please, you can stay tuned for details by looking at the Science Meets Business newsletter, and something will go in the chat about that. You can also look at the ANSTO Innovation e-newsletter. So please sign up to those, and then you'll get notice when we're having our next one, which will be in March 2023. So stay tuned for the next one of these panels, and we look forward to seeing you all there. Thank you so much to everyone for being such an engaged audience in the chat. And thank you again to our panelists. That's it from me, and see you next time.